mercy said no. I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no. Sin will never take control. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. I'm not gonna let you go.
Watch Oracles of God Television to get the untainted gospel of Jesus Christ right out of Africa.
Mercy said no.
When you get it right.
There are some things you will do, people will look at you and wonder.
When you get it right, there are decisions you make because God has enabled you to see the tomorrow. When you get it right, those who are ruled by sense, who hoard the little things that they have in this world, don't know that ultimately they are going to bring those same things and come and bow at your feet with them.
The deadliest spiritual attack arranged against anybody calculated to frustrate you, to stop you, to crush you, to destroy you, is not against your family. The deadliest spiritual attack that is arranged against a person, listen to what I'm saying here, doesn't go after your possessions. The deadliest form of spiritual attack is not when principalities and powers come after you. The deadliest form of spiritual attack is not when witches and wizards begin to murmur incantations and put your name. The deadliest form of spiritual attack is when the darkest personality, the prince of darkness himself, who was quoted as the great dragon, that serpent, Lucifer, when Satan sits down, calls his lieutenants, not the one that God reminded him of your name like Job, but when Satan himself brings your name in his fire and makes plans against you, and you that he's planning against, a lot of your friends don't think much about you. Amen. Because you see, there are many people who are going through frustrations today because they've allowed spiritual attacks to get to them. So when Satan himself, in the situation where we have satanic attack, we're not talking about in the dream. No. While you are awake. Amen. Jesus said, Simon, Simon. If you want to see a spiritual attack that is satanic of the worst kind, open your Bible and see how it happened. He said, behold, that's Simon, Simon, relax and see clearly. Satan, not Asmodi. Hello. Amen. Satan, not the winch in your village. Satan has desired not to go after your money. He's not going after your possession. He's not going after your family. Satan has desired to have you. He's coming after you. And he's not coming after you because he's planning to keep you as a trophy. He has made intention known to his lieutenants. What he plans to do with you, he wants to sift you. Satan has sworn, by the time I'm finished with that boy called Ladi Thompson, he has sworn, by the time I'm finished with him, look, nothing will remain. That is a satanic attack that is directed at you personally, knowing full well that if he can stop you, he stops your finances, he stops your blessings, he stops your possessions, stops everything else. But what is the answer in a case where a satanic attack cannot be prevented anymore. What is the answer when Satan has concluded all protocols in the realm of the spirit and is coming after a person? If anybody will know about spiritual warfare, the best person to know about spiritual warfare is none other than the captain of captains, the Lord of lords, the King of kings himself, whose name is Satan. Has desired to have you and to mess you and to finish you, but I got a solution. I am going to pray. Somebody say pray. What's my prayer point? 2,000 volts of electricity against every satanic attack. Every mirror that is following you to be broken into pieces. Every person who took your umbilical cord when we are born, who buried it under the sea and crocodile ate it. All those silly, ridiculous things that the Nigerian church is playing games with. When there's a spiritual attack that is leveled against you that cannot be avoided, there's only one thing that can deliver you: your faith. Tell your neighbor, say, my faith. Satan has desired to have you and sift you as wheat, but I have prayed that your faith will not fail. And hear me. When you are converted from a loser into a winner, when you are converted from being the victim into becoming the victor, when you are converted, there's one thing you need to do: teach everybody else around you how to overcome and how to be established. Go and become a teacher. Teach them, because there will be many people teaching all sorts of funny ways that doesn't work. Teach them how to get total victory. This was the instruction that Jesus gave to Peter. Amen. And that's why later on I told you, Peter had the temerity, the audacity. A fisherman who had never been to college, a fisherman of no certain distinction, became a person who, look, I love reading the Bible. You see the power of God at work. When a man's faith is working, you see the results upon his life. A man who has never been to school, when you read 1 Peter, you'll be saying, he's going for home lesson. By the time you enter 2 Peter, a professor cannot write better than this. And that's why he starts off by saying, Simon Peter, he identifies himself, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, grace and peace be multiplied. Listen to me. Look at the grace of that speech. You know what he's doing here? He's obeying Jesus. The attack came. Satan attacked him, wanted to finish him, wanted to blot his name, block his destiny, ensure he will not be with Christ in eternity. But Satan failed concerning Peter, and Satan will fail concerning you. Amen. But hear me. When we get to the Word of God, we need to understand the ways of God. It was the faith of Peter. Jesus didn't say, I'm praying that my faith will help you. He said, Peter, looking at you, by now, you got faith. Your faith must not fail. Now, a lot of people don't know this, but the Bible says they just shall live by faith. When Peter begins to talk about the great and precious promises by which we become partakers of the divine nature, he's talking about how to strengthen faith. Many people don't understand it. It's become a mystery to the church again, unfortunately. God knows what he's saying. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Sometimes a couple don't have children, they want to have kids. And they know that God, if he's pleased, of course they're going to have children. Sometimes in this generation, you know how they go about it? They want to walk in holiness. It's good. Oh, let me go and be doing restitution. God bless you. I'm going to become a church worker. And when I become a church worker, after 2 or 3 years of church walking, then God will be pleased. I got news for you. This is the problem. When people want to tell God who God should be, instead of learning from God who God is. Without faith, it is what? Tell your neighbor, say, forget about it. You want to please God without faith? Tell your neighbor, say, not possible. Hello. You know, sometimes I listen in Christianity and I've heard all sorts of theories about holiness and some people who try to create a fake holiness that is just not real. But I've seen the one of the Bible. When you are training as a Christian, when you become a believer, one of the things you first learn is how to fall. Never fall backward, fall forward. One of the most deadly things in the faith is the power of adoption. And because we are adopted in the family of God, we are no less members of the family of God than any Jew or any person that came in with the first system. What is the point making the old heaven and not making the new one? Now, God doesn't want you to bother yourself with spiritual technicalities. So what does God want you to aim for? Be a confirmed member of the family where everybody has only one father and we call him Abba Father. Colossians chapter 1. Now before we go there, let me just paint a scenario for you. Why is it that Jesus was talking about faith when spiritual attack was coming? Now, let me just give you a little news. It's not only spiritual attack that faith is good for. What can faith do? If you want to know what faith can do, I can show you from the Bible. There are two things that faith has the power to do. He has the power to create. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. You later find out that the secret was that God, through faith, this earth was framed by the word of God. Through faith. That's the secret. Faith can create. A man comes, he doesn't have a leg. Some years ago, we had a case here. A child was born, no eyes. We began to pray. We knew that this level of prayer is not the level of prayer of God heal the eyes. There are no eyes in the socket. But we had the faith. We held the parents. We joined hands together. In a short while, parents woke up one morning, eyeballs had formed one by one after the other in the child's eyes. Creative faith. What can faith do? Faith can create. Hey! Somebody saying thank you, Jesus. What can faith do? Faith can create. What again can faith do? Because faith is so powerful, faith dominates. You see, many of us don't know this, but Epignosco 2014 is going to be the turning point of your life. When God sends this word to you and you get born again, the power of faith is that it's going to transform you into the best in the earth. You're going to be in this world, but you're not going to be of this world. And you're going to become like that because of faith in God. You see, faith not only creates, it dominates. Wherever faith is walking, go there and push somebody. He starts at a very low position. But just go and come back if there really be faith. That's why I like what James was saying. So stop talking about faith. Show me your faith by the results. Because if there's anything I know about faith, it always carries results. Hello. What can faith do? It can take the poorest person in church here right now and transform you into the wealthiest of the whole lot. What can faith do? Faith can look at you right now. You are surrounded by enemies. You are defeated. You are busted. You are disgusted. Your name has become almost something that is stinking. But by your faith in God, you will dominate all that try to dominate you. What can faith do? Faith can take that record in your family where everybody has been a failure from age 35 up to age whatever it is in certain areas of life. It doesn't matter how many of them have failed before. Because you have faith, your case is different. What can faith do? Faith can take you from being a local person and turn you into an international figure. What can faith do? Faith can bring to this earth solutions from heaven that doesn't exist on the earth. What can faith do? It will make you shine. What can faith do? Doctors can tell you that only one lung you need to manage. What can faith do? Faith will bring a new lung. And if you are not careful, replace the two. Hallelujah. What can faith do? Beloved, the beauty of faith is that it is real. God revealed something to me that I was shocked. I couldn't believe it at first. But then I began to look at it carefully, and God said, look, there are many Christians in your generation who in some years' time are quietly going to be cursing God in their hearts. The Bible says the fool has said there's no God. They're not going to curse God openly. They're going to have meetings, and husband is going to look at wife, wife is going to look at husband. They have never discussed it before, but it's been growing inside them for 15, 20, 35 years. And they say, where is our prophet? Going to church all the time, serving God diligently. They said we should do this. We did it. We studied the Bible. We did the exams. Hello. We did all. But look at our lives right now. Nothing to show. Is there really God? Is there really a God? And the rebellion starts on the inside. Nobody will know, because the person will have completely looked away from faith in God and resigned to what? To faith. Why? Because he looks around him and he says, listen, this evil sin I've not overcome. In church, we know the mask to wear. Everybody, from top to toe. Where's my shout of victory over sin? All these years? Poverty is still hanging around. I'm still afraid every day. No convincing victory over sickness. Left, right, and center, defeat. I look for this one, delay. I look over there, doubt. The husband tapped the wife and said, are you going to church today? So look, we are in the same spirit. Frustrated. Begin to look at God and question God. Like John the Baptist. Are you the one? Or shall we look for another? We have changed church many times. But you see, this is going to be the result, because there's a generation. When Jesus made a statement that when the Son of Man returns, will he meet any faith in the earth? He knew what he was saying. The thing that Satan is afraid of the most is the thing that can dominate him, defeat him, and mess him up. What is Satan afraid of the most? He comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Through faith, you can prevent any stealing. And if they are stolen, you can command restoration, multiple fold. Through faith, they try to kill, you restore to life. Everywhere they talk about destruction, you are talking about expansion. Because of faith. So Satan hates anybody who gets a handle of faith. What can faith do? Everything marked impossible in your life, faith can lift that barrier and make it possible. So what happens when people go to church for many years? They go through all the religious moves. They are ashamed to admit that, look here, I put more trust in my bank statement and my meetings with my banker than in the Word of God. They get to a point in their frustration. They are ashamed to mention, like I said, you buy, watch this, you have more faith in Cadbury than in Bible. Why? A carton of Bonvita, the new design. You haven't opened the carton, but you bought it. But your faith is so confident, you carry the carton from the store, and you're going to your house, and you expect nothing less than Bonvita when you open the case. It doesn't even dawn on you that Cadbury could be telling a lie. Your faith in Cadbury is more than faith in the Word of God. You buy a brand new laptop and they say, no, give me a new one, the one that hasn't been opened. And you are so happy, you take it from the store. You have not even seen the laptop inside the box. But the seal is there. You proudly go home. Now the manual says, once you collect this laptop, it's going to come on and there's going to be some computing today. Amen. With excitement, the first thing you are loading is computer game. Amen. And you know what? You will be surprised if you plug the computer and it doesn't come on. You will actually be shocked. How can that be? You rush back, you want to question. But you know what the truth is? When you trace the frustration of most people, you trace it back to unanswered prayer. You look at people who have been in church for many years, they can't even point to a series or a string of answered prayer. So much so that the church counters now with a strategy of releasing 1 million prayers in hope of success in five. They think that the more the prayer, the more your chances of getting some answered. So we have a modern church, we have a Nigerian church right now, looking at the months ahead and what is coming in Nigeria. Only those with true faith will be established in this country. Let me tell us a little news. The word for Nigeria for now is simple. Arise and shine, your light has come. But follow the Bible well and read. It says that darkness will cover the land and the gross darkness the people. When darkness covers the land, it's bad news. Gross darkness is spiritual. But the Bible is telling you right now that even though there are waves coming, times of terror, times of this and that and that and that, those who are marked by the name of the Lord, those who understand epignosko. Amen. Epignosko. Those who have epignosko, while people are shouting about falling down, lamentations and sorrow, they are busy rejoicing, and so shall you be rejoicing. Amen. Praise the Lord. Are we still together? You see, I'm saying these things before they come to pass, that you may know indeed that Jesus is Lord. I say you shall rejoice. Now, how does somebody tell you that in the office when there's a problem, we use common sense, we sit down, we strategize, when we do it, we already know we'll make it, and we get our results. But you know, every time we go to church, when you bring a problem to church, we masquerade it, we dodge it, we psych it up, we do this, we cover it, we divert it and everything. But you know what the truth is? What is it? And after 25 to 30 years, now those who are just born again, hello, it will never happen to you in Jesus' name. So it's good I'm exposing it. There are masquerades in church. People wearing masks. No answered prayer in 15 to 25 years. They know the scriptures, you are the head, not the tail, and they look at it and say, look, I'm the tail, I'm not the head, leave me.
Join us again same time next week for another transforming experience. Visit our website at www.livingwatersunlimited.org.ng. Our Facebook address is Living Waters Unlimited Church, while our Twitter handles are at LWUC and at Oracle, O-R-A-K-L-E-S. Thank you.
Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal Jesus, mercy said no.